and amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus' name. Yes. Yes, Lord. Faith be strengthened this morning. Yes. Hallelujah. Aren't you happy that we get do-overs? Yes, aren't we? We're so happy, Jesus. Jesus gives us a do-over when we come. It cleans us up. It helps us to stop.
Is your mic on?
My mic is on, hallelujah, okay. But the wrong song is playing.
Absolutely. Yes, well, we see this, dear. Yes. We see this. Let's get it off and let's start this all over again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Lord, I'm going to even start with the prayer.
Yes.
Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah, Lord. We just give you praise, honor, and glory in all things, Father. Even in the things, Father, that looks like this not working right. We know that you are in control of all things. We give you praise, honor, and glory in the house today. Lord, as always, we come in with joy, Father, because we are here to serve you and you alone. And we give you the glory for it, Lord.
Yes,
in Jesus' name.
Oh, thank you,
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Ooh. All right, y'all, it's time to worship. Let's get
Let's
on our
do
feet.
It.
Let's lift our hands. Let's
Hallelujah.
Praise the King of Kings.
Matthew 14:22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship, for Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The disciples saw him and they cried out for fear. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And Jesus said, come.
You called me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never failed and you won't start now. So rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh,
you are mine.
Oh, Jesus, you're mine. You're mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours. You are mine.
And when Peter came out of the ship and he walked on the water, he went to Jesus. And as he was walking, all of a sudden, he lost faith. And when he lost his faith that was Jesus reaching out to him, he started sinking into the water. But Jesus said, Peter, you of O little faith, and he reached out and grabbed him and he pulled him up. And we have to understand that it's no different with us than it was with Peter. Because you see, when we lose our faith as we're going through things in life, then we start sinking. But when we get our faith back and we realize that it's Jesus, and he's there, he's right here beside us. He's never going to leave us. He's never going to forsake us. That's his word. He promised that, and he doesn't change his promises. So no matter where you're at in life, no matter what you're going through, no matter what's happening, just know he's not going to let you sink. He's going to pull you right back up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Spirit is within me because you might keep.
Mercy. There's nothing like it. Hallelujah. So I want to take just a minute here this morning. You know, it's Veterans Weekend. Yesterday was Veterans Day. And I'm going to ask Pastor Joe to come up here for just a minute, if he would. Because you see, Pastor Joe was, not only is he a paramedic, he's a pastor, but he was also, he's a vet, because he did serve our country. So I would just like to honor him for just a moment and tell him, you know, we love him and we thank him. You don't have to leave, sister. We love him. We're thankful. And I'm thankful for him and his heart. Thank you first, Pastor Joe, for your serving our country and for loving your country the way that you do. I cannot even tell you. I can't tell you the love this man has in his heart for this country. I see it all the time, you know. And you'll notice he's dressed up in his gear this morning. But he's gearing up, because I'm going to tell you he's got a message for you today. But to all of our vets out there, let us just say we love you. We thank you guys for everything that you have done and all that you're doing to serve our country. Because we also understand, and I'm going to go out and just say a little bit further, that our country has not served you as well. So for that, we're going to ask you from Van Cleve Worship Center, forgive us. Because, you know, we should be serving our guys while they're serving the country. Hallelujah. As well as we serve Christ in the midst of all of it. So I just want to say thank you, Pastor. We appreciate you and we love you. Thank you. Hallelujah. All right. So now we're going to sing a song to our vets. Is there anybody else in the house? I don't think there is today that has been a part of the military. But if there is, we just want to say thank you. And we say thank you over the wire again. We have some of our people that are connected to this church that are not in this city or that are not even in this state. And they served with Pastor Joe. So Sterling and Mark, we love you. We thank you. We appreciate you and all that you did with Pastor Joe in our service. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
So if you would stand with us and let's honor America today. Let's serve the country that we live in and love on her for just a moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Hold up.
Well, that was the first thing I was going to do, but they won't be able to see. I was getting ready to. It's okay. Yeah, I was getting ready to do the same thing. I was like, no. Here we go. I hear you, sister. Yes.
You know, we'll serve our country this morning. Hallelujah. All right, Cam, let's go. Thank you, Jesus. y'all sing with us this morning.
Tomorrow all the things were gone I've worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, and New York to L.A. Well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I'll gladly stand up defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right. Next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just give you the praise, the honor, and the glory this morning. We just thank you, Lord, for all that you have already done. And Lord, we ask you at this moment in time, every soldier, Father, not only here for America, but the soldiers over in Israel, Father, the soldiers that have come from all the countries that have sent their people, Father, to help Israel. We ask you, Lord God, send your peace upon them. Send your protection upon them. Heavenly Father, we know as we look up in the sky, we can see that you have angels guarding Israel. For Lord God, we also know your word says there's a time they're going to try to come against them, but you, O Lord, will protect them. You tell us to pray for peace for Jerusalem. So Lord, today we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we stand, Father, together as we ask you also, those that are in Congress here in America, Heavenly Father, please, we beg you, give their hearts that change that they need, Father, that murder will stop in our country from killing our babies. And Lord, they will protect our soldiers in Jesus' name. We give you praise, honor, and glory, Lord. As always, we know that you were the strongest, bravest soldier that ever existed. So we love you, Lord. We thank you for what you did that day at Calvary, that we can all have eternal life with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
I just want to say that we truly need to bless our service people. We ask God to stand beside each and every one of them, keep them safe and strong. And Lord, we thank them and you for the blessings that you've given us. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for the gifts that you give us each and every day. And we just give you all the honor and the praise. And Lord, just be with each and every person here today. But you know, we look around and we say, look at Biloxi and the United States. We love each and every person. And we want to help each and every person that we can. In Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen.
Pastor Jen.
Okay, all right, I'm sorry. We're having a lot of technical difficulties this morning, and one of them was my fault. Yeah, what? What? Yeah, I say it on here, so don't do like I did.
I just wanted to say that we need to go out and look. We can't take people away from other churches. That's just not the way to do things. But there's people out there all over the place that don't have a church or a place to go. And we need to promote our church. This is our home.
Yes.
This is where God comes to help us. And so I just wanted to ask that in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you. All right, let me start our announcements back over since I forgot to turn my mic on. First of all, we have a sister that is needs some prayer. Cheryl, if you're watching, Cheryl, we're praying with you. Like I said, that for those that didn't get to hear me because I didn't have my mic on, she's battled cancer once before and came out victorious. Now she's doing it again. And she's going to be victorious again in Jesus' name. All right. So she's got to go through a few things, I think a surgery and maybe some chemo and radiation. But Cheryl, if you're watching, we're there with you, and we're praying with you, and we know you're going to come out victorious on this. And we love you. Also, as I had talked about last week, we do have a end-of-the-year need, financial need for the church that we're believing in God for. And so I just, you know, just asking if everybody that's watching online that, you know, pray about this. What does God have in your heart that you're to sow into this ministry, to see this ministry going and continue to be a beacon of light? You know, we were prophesied several times of growth in the church, and I believe it. And I'm holding on to those prophecies because God's word says that his word never goes out and comes back void, but it always accomplishes that which he has sent it forth to do. Okay? So sometimes we got to just stand in faith and just say, Lord, I believe you no matter what, and I'm going to stand there. But if the God's got it on your heart to sow into this ministry, there's a couple ways you can give. You can go to our website, which is www.vancleavewc.org. I hope I got a big enough one on the screen up here that you can see it now. Or you can send a check or money order to VWC at 9107 Nannies Road, Van Cleve, Mississippi, 39565. Today, we're celebrating Veterans Day. Veterans Day was yesterday, but we're going to recognize it today. And as Pastor Rachel said, we just thank all those who had served our country that are watching this today, that are here. We just thank you for your service and your dedication to our country. Amen. Go ahead and put my PowerPoint up, Cameron. So today I want to bring a Veterans Day service in order to recognize our veterans. He's getting it. There we go. Okay. All right. So I'm going to ask everybody if you would just stand as we read God's word. Second Timothy 4:7 says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Heavenly Father, Lord, veterans all over can say that today, Lord, that they fought the good fight. Lord, some of them are still fighting the good fight. Some of them has completed their course. They've completed the race, Lord God. And Lord, have still kept the faith in their country and in their Lord Jesus Christ. So, Lord, today, we're just asking you, Lord, as we honor veterans, God, we're asking you to touch every active duty military person, man and woman, every veteran, Lord God, that, Lord, that you just touch their heart right now, Lord. If they don't know you, oh, Lord God, Lord, to just speak into their heart that they may come to know you as Lord and Savior, Father God. Lord, that you'll send somebody to them, God, to speak to them and that their hearts and their ears will become open, Lord God, to know who you are, God. Lord, today we thank you for our veterans, God. And Lord, we thank you for the greatest veteran of all, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's children said, amen, amen. Cameron, if you would go back to that Veterans Day slide for me, I appreciate it. All right. Y'all may be seated. Even though Veterans Day was yesterday, it's done on every November 11th. However, it's important enough to celebrate it today, the day after the holiday. See, unlike Memorial Day, when we honor those who died while serving, Veterans Day celebrates the service of all U.S. military veterans, alive and those who have gone on and crossed that river. Originally, it was called Armistice Day, commemorating the end of World War I. That was on the 11th month, the 11th day, the 11th minute after the 11th hour. But it was expanded in 1954 to honor and celebrate all who served in our armed forces during times of war and times of peace. See, we owe our veterans a great debt for their service. Without them, we wouldn't have a free country. We wouldn't have America to what we have today. But see, I also want to include the loved ones of those who served. Because let me tell you something, being a military spouse, a military wife, a military husband, you have to endure a lot. And a lot of times you're not recognized during the during Veterans Day, just the sacrifice that you went through. You were there when your husband and your wife was deployed. You had to take care of the household while they were gone. You had to take care of the kids while they were gone. All the things that they normally do, now you had to do while they were gone. That is a huge sacrifice. And you're praying every day that God brings your husband, brings your wife back home safely. That they can come back home to their sons, to their daughters. That they can have their daddy or their mama back. Right? So thank you to all those wives, those husbands, that of military service members that have served as well too. Because trust me, you served. You know, these are the ones that gives us the incentive to serve. Our loved ones back home. You know, I remember when I was in, when I was away in the Navy, what kept me going was knowing that I have people back home that loved me. I had people back home that were looking forward to me getting back. I had friends, I had family that I knew that these were the ones that I were fighting for. And that if I died while fighting for them, it was worth it. So we have to give a great thanks to those who stayed behind while the other ones served. So thank you, veterans, and those who supported them for your service and your sacrifices. This morning, I would like to expand the term veteran, not to just who served or are actively serving in our American military, but what about those ones that are actively serving in the Lord's army as well? They're fighting a fight, right? Paul reminds us in Ephesians 6:12, he says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." See, this is the grim reality that as a soldier of the Lord's army, we face on a continual basis. This is a battle that we're constantly fighting against those in the heavenly places. Whether we're fighting the fight as a pastor, whether we're fighting the fight as a teacher, whether we're fighting the fight as just somebody who's going through a lot that the devil is constantly attacking, it seems like. The ones that, the devil's constantly wanting to battle with them. They're in the prayer closet. They're fighting the good fight. There was a movie that was put up by the Kendrick brothers called The War Room. All right? And they called it the War Room for a very good reason. This lady had a room in her house that she went into, and she battled the devil every single day in prayer. She fought the good fight constantly. She's a veteran. She's a veteran of God's army. If you've never seen that movie, War Room, I encourage you to get that movie and watch it. It's going to help you rethink how we fight the good fight. See, because as a veteran in the Lord's army, there is no peacetime. There's only daily combat. There's no honorable discharge from active duty during this lifetime. We fight the good fight from the time we get saved to the time we go meet the Lord in the air. Amen? We constantly have to fight the fight. We can't give it up. We've got to every single day do battle. So we're all veterans in the Lord's army. For those who complete their tour of duty in this army honorably, there are eternal benefits. Look, complete life insurance. All right? Life insurance forever and ever. No death. Hallelujah. Look at that. There's no need for medical benefits because there will be no more sickness, no more death, no mourning or crying or pain. In fact, the only scars in heaven will be on the hands of Christ welcoming his veterans home. Hallelujah. See, let me get this back over here because I'm going to show you something. We've got two flags here. Yeah. I'm trying not to cover this here. I want you to see these two flags right here that I'm going to talk about. See, there's two flags here at my side. The American flag, which represents our country, and the Christian flag representing our Lord Jesus Christ and his kingdom, with his cross imprinted on it. To serve in the army of either of these flags faithfully and effectively, and the kingdom they represent, both have certain requirements. Our spiritual focus and the other are physical requirements. So the first thing that we have to understand is there is an enlistment in this army. Cam. All right. Recruitment into either army is at present is voluntary. See, right now there is no forced draft in America anymore. A lot of people are saying, especially the 18-year-olds, the young ones, right? I remember I had to sign up for the draft. Some of you are probably really familiar with it, and then there's people that's been drafted into the military. And, man, it was a requirement for a young man at 18 years old. You had to go to the post office, and you had to fill out that draft card, and then you were always worried about if you were going to be drafted. See, that's one of the reasons I joined the Navy. It's because I didn't want to be drafted into the Army. I wanted the man where if I was in combat, the reason I joined the Navy, if I got into combat, I wanted to die clean. I didn't want to die in the mud. At least if the shrimp went down, I'd get washed off with all that water that's out there, right? I died clean. But right now there is no draft in the United States anymore, nor are people drafted into God's army, all right? We don't grab people by the hair of the head and kicking and screaming up to the altar and make them confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, right? So it's all voluntary. This is because people love their country and because people love the Lord that they serve in these armies. Amen? Yeah. But see, both send recruiters to encourage people to volunteer to serve. We have recruiters that, man, I tell you what, when you in junior high, these recruiters are starting to come and visit you, all right, telling you what the Army can do for you, what the Navy can do for you, that the Marines is much better, and that the Air Force, man, you know, they tell you what all that you can do, what they can do for you while you're still in high school to entice you to join. But see, we also have to be out there recruiting other people into God's army too. And how do we do that? We tell them the benefits. Just like the recruiters go out there and they tell the young people the benefits of joining the military, the benefits that you can have, the educational benefits, the health benefits that you get and everything else. We need to start telling people about the benefits of Jesus Christ. Look at this, the health benefits, all right? Man, by his stripes you are healed. Hallelujah. Right? In heaven there is going to be no sickness. There's not going to be no death, no weeping, no pain. You know? What about the life benefits of heaven? Right? Eternal life with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Right? We got to tell people that. The thing is 90% of the people that don't go to church has been polled and said because they were never invited. 90% of the people that don't go to church, they don't go because they were not invited. What does that tell us about the veterans of God's army? We're not doing our job as recruiters, right? And I'm not talking about professional liars. We don't need to lie about the benefits of Christ's army. We need to tell them the truth because guess what? The benefits are outstanding. This out of this world. Hallelujah. See, Jesus invites the army recruiters target specific audiences, the young people. But Jesus invites each of us, young, old, no matter what race, no matter what religion, no matter what ethnical background, no matter anything, he invites everybody to come and follow me. But see, not everyone is fit to join. Wow. It's kind of odd to hear that, isn't it? Not everybody is fit to join. See, the American Army requires you to pass a physical, mental, and character test. But see, Jesus tests our commitment to him. See, just like he did the rich young ruler who came to Jesus and appeared to be willing to join the kingdom army, but proved to be unfit. See, Matthew talks about Jesus said it was asked of a young man how to enter God's kingdom. Let's look at that in Matthew 19, 16 through 21. He said, "Now behold, one came to him, to Jesus, 'Good teacher, what good things do I do that I might have eternal life?' So he said to him, 'Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments.' He said to him, 'Which ones?' Jesus said, 'You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You should not steal. You should not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.'" Now, see, I want to stop here just a moment. I want you to see that these are the parts of the Ten Commandments that has to deal with how we treat other people. All right? We don't steal from them. We don't lie on them or lie to them. We honor our father and our mother. We don't covet what they have. All right? We don't commit adultery. See, this is all with other people. This is what the young man said. He said to him, he says, "All these things I have kept from my youth, but what do I still lack?" And Jesus said to him, "If you want to be perfect, go and sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me." See, the thing is here, Jesus is saying to him, now you have to obey the first parts of the Ten Commandments, which is have no other God but the Lord God. Don't take the Lord's name in vain. Keep the Sabbath day holy. All right? See, this is what he's talking about here. Now, this is how we deal with God in this one here, not how we deal with other people. So what happened with this young man? But the young man, when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. See, Jesus tested his commitment, telling him to sell all that he had and give it to the poor. And the man failed the test. Why? Because he put all that he had ahead of God. He put everything that he owned, all the great possessions he had, the wealth that he had, the prestige that he had, the influence that he had. He put all this before God, so he failed the only requirement in God's army, and that's the total commitment to God. All right? We got to be totally committed to God to pass the test to get into God's army. See, what it is Jesus wasn't asking for the man's wealth. He wasn't asking for the man's prestige. He wasn't even asking for anything that the man had. Because they all possessed this young man. Everything that he had wasn't his possessions. They possessed him. That's why he couldn't get rid of them. Because they possessed him. You know, I'm going to say just the other day, Pastor Rachel and I went to go eat. And we came out and getting in the car. And this older gentleman came up there and he pulled up beside us, and he says, "Sir?" I said, "Yes, sir." I thought he was going to, like, ask for directions or something like that. He says, "I think I just hit your car." And I said, "Oh, okay. Well, I looked on this side over here, and I didn't see nothing. We looked on the other side in the front, and there's some scuffs where he had hit the car." All right? It's so easy to get mad about that. It's so easy to just fly off the handle and just say, "Why? What's the matter? Why didn't you look? Didn't you see where you were going?" How many times somebody would say stuff like that, right? They would get all mad about it and everything. But it's like Rachel says, she heard from the Holy Spirit. It's a car. It's a car. It can be fixed. It's a car. Why destroy this man with our words when it's just a car? Do we own the car or does the car own us? Right, Pastor Rachel? All right. See, this is where this young man was. This young man was not that he owned the possessions, because if he owned the possessions, then he could have given them away. But because they possessed him, he couldn't give them away. See, in Christ's army, we must commit to him above all things. Above all things. See, effective soldiers in Christ's command must be loyal, obedient, and have faith in Jesus Christ alone. Nothing else do we put our hope on. Nothing else do we build our foundation on. Jesus said one time, he says, to build your foundation not on me is like those who build their house on sinking sand. When the wind comes and the rain blows and the waves comes and washes the sand out, the house falls with a crash. He says, but those who build their hope on Jesus Christ, it's like building a house on a solid rock. Though the wind blows and the rain falls and the waves come, the house stands. And that's why we must build our faith only on Jesus Christ. See, Jesus' 12 disciples, they... I'm looking at this and I'm reading disciples and commitment at the same time. Okay. But Jesus' 12 disciples, they had commitment. They voluntarily left their homes and their careers to follow Jesus Christ. They knew who they wanted to follow. They knew where they wanted to put their faith. You know, people say a lot of times, well, I don't think that Jesus really was who he said they are. But let me tell you something. Except for Judas, every other disciple of Jesus Christ was martyred, was horribly executed, and never, ever recanted their faith. Now I'm going to tell you something. If it wasn't true, if Jesus wasn't the Son of God, if he didn't die on a cross and raise from the grave again, that they had saw him, and if that wasn't the truth, when it came time to give their life for it, do you think they're going to give their life for a lie? They gave their life because they knew it was true, and they clung to the promise that Jesus gave them. When he says, if you lay down your life, you shall find it. You'll find it with him eternally. And their commitment was strong to him because they knew who he was. And see, we have to have that same commitment and to voluntarily follow him and give our life to his service. As veterans in Christ's armies, we have additional duties as recruiters as well. Jesus sent us out to his recruitment officers to urge others to serve in his army. That means we got to spread the gospel. We got to tell people about it. Just like Brother Mike was saying, this is our church. This is our home. We need to tell people about this place. We need to tell people. I mean, there are signs out here, and we did get one family for a short while because he drove by and he saw the sign. And he says, wow, there's a church there. I'm going to go there. But when he came here, he said that this is the only church that he has ever been to that people actually loved on him. He left because he moved to another part of the state. But he just called us, both Mike and I, the other day, how he missed his church family. He said he's going to come back to visit again, and he's going to come back because he says, I love that worship. Hallelujah. But see, we got to tell people about Jesus Christ. We got to tell people about the church that's here and invite them. Like I said before, 90% of the people that don't go to church says because they've never been invited. That's sad. That's very sad. See, as top recruiters in Jesus' army, Paul, he wrote this in 2 Corinthians 5:20. He says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. Now, I want to ask you something. When a country sends out an ambassador to another country, what is the sole job of that ambassador? To represent and to promote the country that they came from, right? Well, I mean, when we send ambassadors to, say, Israel, or we send ambassadors to Japan, or to Germany or to England or wherever we have ambassadors, do we think that we send those people to promote their own agenda, to promote the agenda of the country that they went to? No. It's to promote the agenda of the country in which they represent, to bring goodwill of the country that which they represent. And that's why we are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Why are we not out there representing what Jesus Christ is all about? Why are we not out there telling people and promoting Jesus Christ? We should be, right? That's what our job is as Christians, is to tell people about Jesus Christ. Amen? So he says, now we are ambassadors for Christ. Now we know who we are, right? As though God were pleading through us, look at this. As he were pleading through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Do you see what we need to be doing here now? God is imploring through you, his ambassadors, to people to be reconciled to him. Wow. Does that give a whole new meaning for you to understand who you are in Jesus Christ? We have to be in his army and fight the good fight. This is fighting the good fight. See, as recruiters, we are his ambassadors, speaking his words to others through his Holy Spirit. Another thing that they do in the military is training. Once new recruits commit to serve in the American Army, they are sent to boot camp. And that's where they get there and they look around and say, Lord, what did I get myself into? All right? If you've never been to boot camp, you're standing there. I got there at night. It's probably about 11 o'clock at night, right? And they had us all standing on this line, and they were screaming and hollering at us, things that I'm not going to repeat here in church, okay, all right, calling us all kinds of names and getting in our faces and everything, and I was like, Lord, what did I get myself into? Whew, man. And there's times in Christ's army, we're like, Lord, why did we get it? When God called us to start this church, right? I'm going to tell you something. Here, even recently, there's times Pastor Rachel and I looked at each other and say, did we do what God called us to do? Is this really what God has got us to do? How did we get ourselves into this? All right? But guess what? We know. Just like I knew I needed to be in the military, I know that this is what Christ has called for me to do. Amen? But see, one of the things that when we get into boot camp, we're given a new look. We begin to learn about our new life and what is expected of us. And most importantly, we begin to train how to become effective combatants. One of the old sayings is train how you fight so that you fight how you were trained. See, the new recruits start off with a haircut. I remember the haircut. See, because I had long hair, and I had these big old Elvis Presley sideburns. You know what I'm talking about? This guy says, he gets in there and sits down in the barber chair, and he says, you like a little off the top? I said, yeah, just a little. He says, you want to keep your sideburns? Sure. Got an envelope? Here you go. So I got to keep my sideburns. Not on my face, though. But so we get a new haircut. We get these clothes. Man, they're not even designer clothes. And what's worse is we all look alike now. I can't even stand that. We all got a haircut that's just kind of almost like the one I got right now. All right? And we all dress the same. Man, if we didn't have our name on our shirts, we wouldn't know who each other was. But see, we also start undergoing physical training. Man, I remember 1 5-day in boot camp. The worst day of boot camp. And that was the day they came in and they cycled you till they couldn't cycle you anymore. Cycle means that they would say, push-up position. Begin and start counting off. And they're like, you get up to like 25. No, what number is that? And you try, he goes, I don't think that's the number. We're going to start all over again. One. Mountain builders. Man, I hate mountain builders right now. Man, I tell you what. You know? Or we'd walk with the rounds with the rifles. These were M1 rifles, which are heavy enough, but they would fill the barrel full of lead and make it even so much heavier. And you'd have to walk around with that thing over your head like this right here. Let me tell you something. That sucker got so heavy so quick. But, man, it was all for physical training to get you ready for battle. See, but Jesus focuses not on the outside like the military does. Jesus focuses us on the inside. That's why Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, he says that if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. Hallelujah. See, we become changed on the inside. We become cleaned up on the inside. We become washed away on the inside with Jesus Christ. See, and this even will change us the way we are on the outside. See, because we won't be talking the same talk anymore. All right? Our language changes. Instead of cussing like a sailor, now I'm sounding like a preacher, right? See, we may even change the way we look, all right? That we may start wearing different clothes, ones that's not so offensive, or start covering ourselves up and being more modest. Our attitudes will probably change, and how we treat people. We won't treat people like we used to. I remember, man, back when before I got saved, my whole motto was, I don't get even, I get ahead. I'm going to get you before you can get me. But see, my whole motto has changed now. As I love you no matter who you are, and I want to show Christ's love to you. Right? So we are a new creation in Jesus Christ. And see, James even tells us that we should control our tongues. So we change the language that comes from within us. Not only just do we not curse, but what about we don't cut people down anymore, right? We don't take the opportunities to belittle people anymore. See, the other night was a classic example. We could have cut this guy down with our language and belittled him because he didn't watch out for it's a bright blue car, and it was under a street light. How could you not see it, is what we could have said. Are you blind? Where'd you get your license from, a Cracker Jack's box? You know? See, we've all heard this before, probably even said it ourselves, right? But the thing is he was so upset that he did this. And he says, he told me, Rachel got in the car, and he told me, he says, I think your wife's really mad at me. I says, well, this is her brand new car. He goes, oh, God. Oh, I can't. And he goes and he knocks on the window and she rolls. And he says, I am just so sorry I hit your brand new car. And he was about to cry. That's when she said, it's just a car. It can get fixed. It's just a car. I think the man went away feeling better. You know? And you want to know something else? We were talked about if we were going to call his insurance, because we didn't call the police. We just swapped insurance and we swapped names and phone numbers and stuff like that, you know. And then we were talking about whether we were even going to call his insurance company. He called his insurance company and they called me the very next day. So, but it's just our whole attitude changed. The way we talk to people changes. The language that comes from us is not of the world's language, but now it becomes the heavenly language. Loving on people, telling people how much Jesus loves them. See, and we may even be more careful about what we put into our body now that we know that this is the temple of the Holy Spirit. I used to smoke. I don't smoke anymore. You know? I used to go drink beer all the time. I don't do that anymore. Why? Because this is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And I don't want to do things that's harmful to God's temple. God don't want to live in no smoky temple. See, such things causes us to love one another and become more understanding and more forgiving. And just as American military requires a lot of classroom training. And see, I'm going to tell you something. In boot camp, there was a lot of classroom training. I learned that I can stand up and sleep in boot camp. I did it. All right? Well, Jesus' boot camp also requires training. Church classroom training. Studying the Bible as his basic training manual. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved to God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. See, so many times we get people that tell us, oh, well, the Bible says God helps those who help themselves. No, it doesn't. All right? I had a guy even told me one time, says, well, the Bible says if you steal to eat that it's okay. It's not a sin. No, the Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says thou shalt not steal. That's pretty plain and simple, right? Thou shalt not steal. Doesn't give you any ifs, ands, ors, or buts, right? But see, if you don't know the word, then you can't rightly divide the word. And you can be led astray by every false wind of doctrine. And then you're no longer in God's army. See, neither army affords soldiers an end to their training. Just when you're in the American military, you are constantly training. It don't matter how old you are. It don't matter what rank you are. Everybody is constantly going through training because the enemy is always lurking and on its search and destroy mission, just as it is in God's army. Did you know that Jesus even himself went through basic training? He prepared for the ministry. The Bible says that when he was young, it says that he grew in admonition of man and God. Why? Because he studied. Why do you think at 12 years old, he was able to sit among the priest and the high priest in the temple and discuss the word of God and even was able to teach them what the word of God said? Because he studied it. He studied to show himself approved. Amen? So Jesus even went through basic training. He went through the hardest part of basic training when after he was baptized, all right, he went to the mountain and he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, right? And what happened? Boy, he went through the trials then. But see, Satan was no match for Jesus. Jesus proved himself a combatant, tested, worthy as a commanding officer, ready to lead his soldiers into battle. Our American military has produced some high-quality leaders, such as General Colin Powell, whose books on leadership show his exemplary abilities and provide valuable training for soldiers even today. But see, Jesus' lessons on wisdom and leadership are recorded in the Bible are far beyond even those while Jesus served his ministry here on the earth, which is recorded in the Gospels. Jesus' teaching were woven throughout the entire Bible. Our Old Testament lesson from the very first chapter of Isaiah is an important lesson for us as soldiers. This is where the prophet Isaiah tells us in Isaiah 1:16-17. He says, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away the evil of your doings from before your eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, and plead for the widow. Wow, that tells us what we really see. You know, we got so many Christians today. They think, well, man, I've said my prayer and I've got dunked in water. Now I can go do anything that I want to do because of God's grace. You know, it's almost like I call it God's greasy grace. Man, if I just get lathered up in God's greasy grace and I just slide my way right on into heaven, right? though that sin may try to, that I'm dealing with, the sin that I'm playing around with, it might have tried to attach itself to me, but I'm going to just slide right out of it by God's greasy grace. But that's not what the Word of God says, right? He tells us to cease to do from to do evil. Stop it. If it's evil, don't do it. All right? Learn to do good. Learn to do what God wants us to do. What did He tell us to do? You know, so many times, I've said this before, so many times people think the Bible's a book of don'ts. You know, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that. And they're like, man, what could we ever get to do? Well, to me, the Bible's a book of do's. The Bible tells us to do this. He says, to love your neighbor as yourself, all right? To do righteous, to seek Him above all things. See, there's so many do's in the Bible that if you do all the do's, you don't have time to do the don'ts. But if you did, you wouldn't, so it's cool, right? So we gotta understand that the Bible is a book of do's, not a book of don'ts. But here the Word tells us that we are to do and stay away from evil, to do good. Seek justice. Rebuke the oppressor. That means we can't be the oppressor, right? We can't be oppressing people. We have to rebuke, defend the fatherless, and plead for the widow. See, like the soldier in boot camp, we have become a new creation and are in training for the causes of our commanding general, Jesus. Isaiah further reveals God's assurance that if we follow His orders, become willing and obedient, we will know victory. If not, we will be devoured by the sword of the enemy. We won't survive combat with the enemy without Jesus Christ. Amen. So the third thing I want to talk about is service. Can you get me a water? American military recruits don't stay in boot camp for very long. Thank God. Whew. Man, I tell you what, that was one of the happiest days of my life, is to be graduating from boot camp, man. I tell you what, when they said today's the day that it's over, I was so happy. I was just, man, I got to walk the walk and marching in the graduation parade. Man, that was a happy day for me. No longer was I in boot camp. And then I got to learn when I got to school, and my chief would say something. I'd say, sir, yes, sir. Here you go. I'm a chief. I'm not a sir. I work for a living. All right? Well, we didn't have to snap at attention every time somebody higher ranking came by. Life was a little bit easier. So we don't stay in boot camp very long. See, now they're needed in the field to fight against the enemy. Graduates from boot camp are assigned to different areas of expertise. Some go to infantry units. Some go to tank corps. Some go to heavy weapon units. Or like me, go to ships. Or the ones I really wanted to stay away from were planes. Just as Jesus' recruits go to various churches as pastors, teachers, lay speakers, and administrators, it takes a variety of skills and continued training for a church team to become an effective combatant unit. See, if it doesn't matter what you serve, where area you serve in the church, right? You are an effective member of the team. I don't care if you say, well, all I do is vacuum the rug. Well, I'm glad I don't have to come in and the rug's filthy, you know, that I wouldn't be afraid to kick off my shoes and run barefooted in it, you know. Well, you know, I take out the trash. Well, thank God the trash cans aren't overflowing, you know. What about those who clean the bathroom? Do you want to go sit in a nasty gas station bathroom? You know, I've been in them ones where you look at it and you go, you got to use the bathroom real bad. You walk in there, you go, no, I'm good. I don't have to anymore. I mean, you want that in your church? But we got people who do it, right? And they're effective team members. Just because they're not the pastor or they're not the worship leader or maybe they're not the teacher in there. Every single person as a member of God's team, even if the only job that you do is praying for this church, you're an effective team member for this church. All right? Those that are online that are praying for our church every day, thank you for what you do. From the bottom of my heart, I say thank you. Because you're going to be praying people into this church to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and get saved. All right? So we need you praying for this church, being an effective combatant with us, a part of our army. Hallelujah. See, we are all part of the same unit. And training continues to increase the effectiveness of Jesus' army of the churches. Church members, once new recruits, become seasoned veterans. We become the ones who are out there and are getting new recruits, telling people about Jesus Christ. Veterans who recruit others. Veterans who train less experienced veterans. Teachers, pastors, you know, our worship team leader. See, these are in the training areas that we're training other people in. Amen. See, we see the great example of this in the New Testament of St. Paul. His second letter to Timothy. Paul had met Timothy as a young man and who may have already been recruited as a disciple. We don't know. It doesn't say whether Paul led him to the Lord or he had already been led to the Lord and then he met with Paul. But he may have already undergone his boot camp training. However, look at how Paul speaks to him in 1 Timothy 1:2. He says to Timothy, a true son of the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. See, Paul started taking Timothy under his wing. He called him a son in the faith, that he was going to teach Timothy how to be an effective leader in it. Because he also, Timothy was become a pastor of one of the churches in Ephesus. So he called him a true son in the faith, which shows that he was teaching him. Paul took him into his heart and began to take him on mission trips, began to train him before appointing him as a messenger to the unruly Corinthian church, and later as a pastor to the Ephesians. From Paul's two epistles to Timothy, our scripture lesson is part of Paul's encouraging words to his young protege, Timothy's faith. The captain stooped to embrace the private. Wow. Can you just see that? I know it didn't happen on my ship. I don't know what would happen if my captain reached down and hugged me like that. I don't know. That would freak me out probably. But Paul was writing from his prison. And he was chained in chains while doing this, but yet he still encouraged Timothy to be strong in the grace that is in Jesus Christ. He still was teaching him, even though he was in prison, even though he was in chains, still had the heart to teach Timothy. That's how we need to be to other people. No matter what we're going through, we need to be willing to encourage and teach other young people. See, he even told Timothy that he must look upon himself as one of the prisoners of Christ's army, a tried veteran and a good soldier of Jesus Christ, prepared for the danger and the trials in which those days awaited to such a calling. Paul advises him in 2 Timothy 2:3-4, he says, you must therefore endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one who engages in warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life, but that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. You know, Paul's writing could have been written for any one of us. When we get tangled up into the messes of the world, false teachings, political commitments, see, our commanding officer is under the American flag instead of the Christian flag. Instead, see, I'm not trying to say we shouldn't be involved in America's, because I certainly am. Pastor Rachel told you, I love this country. You know, I love this country with all my heart. And I've said it before and I say it again, that if I was able to do it all over again, I would do it all over again. Maybe change a few things, but I would do it all over again. But see, so we got to be involved in the things like voting. We got to be involved in things like opposing the wrongs of society and supporting the good things. But our first allegiance is as a veteran to Christ's army. See, should be wanting to please Christ, our commanding officer. That is what we do under the American flag, should not entangle us from what we do in the Christian faith. See, I love our country. I served our country. I was willing to die for our country. But now, I also know this is where my commanding officer, this represents my commanding officer. Jesus is my first commitment. Jesus is my first love. I tell Pastor Rachel, we say it to each other all the time. I love you more than anybody on this earth except Jesus Christ. And when she tells me that, that makes me happy. That her first commitment is to Jesus Christ. Because then I know she's going to be the godly wife that God has called her to be. That was promised to me. And she knows that when my first commitment is to Jesus Christ as her husband, I'm going to be the godly man that was promised to her. But I can only do that by making my first commitment Jesus Christ. See, if it came a choice between serving Jesus Christ or serving my country, I serve Jesus Christ. And if it came a choice between serving Jesus Christ or honoring our country, I serve Jesus Christ. I honor him first. All right? He comes before all things. And that's where we have to be in his army. We have to be dedicated to our commanding officer, Jesus Christ. See, then what we do under the American flag will not entangle us up and keep us from our Christian duty and our faith if we put Jesus first. In the military, the soldier serves. The longer a soldier serves, the more experience and the wisdom that veteran soldier possesses. The more responsibility can be given to them. They're given higher ranks. They're given higher areas of responsibility. And the more others come up through the ranks can look to him or her as an example for guidance and for training. See, just like in the Christian army, the longer we serve, the more we learn, the more responsibilities is given to us, the more that we can do, and the more people start looking up to us growing up in their faith. See, I've had people call me that don't even go to this church. Brother, I need to ask you a question. What does the Bible mean when it says this? Or where in the Bible where is this at? You know? I mean, that's pretty cool I expect that out of our church members. But we sometimes get other church members, people, they go to other churches calling me up. And I answer their questions. Why? Because they look up. Not because of who I am. All right? Not because of who I am. All right? But it was because I committed myself to the training of Jesus Christ. See, just like Paul was for Timothy. We have all been recruited into Christ Church, his army. We need to train daily to learn more about what pleases our Lord, preparing to fight against Satan and his army. To be true veterans, continually serving to be better, stronger soldiers, not just bystanders. Proud veterans that follow our commanding officer out of our love for him, our faith in him, and our loyalty to him. But there is one universal lesson to be learned by veterans of churches and soldiers and even sports teams. You have to keep your focus on the leader. You have to keep your focus on Jesus Christ. What would happen in a football team if the quarterback was ready to throw the ball, but the people were not keeping their focus on him? He could throw the ball. Okay? But when it got to the player, if his focus was on something else, he would completely miss the ball. And they wouldn't be able to score. Right? Military, if they don't keep their focus on the leader who's instructing them how to fight the battle, they could actually wind up doing the wrong thing. There's been times that people in the military has not listened, has not kept their focus on their commanding officer, and has actually fired at friendly people. Friendly fire. People have been killed by friendly fire because they didn't keep their focus. They didn't do what they were told to do. They didn't direct their fire, their weapons to the right place. And if we don't keep our focus on Jesus Christ, see what happens as Christians is we who are shod of the gospel of peace, have the belt of truth and the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, the sword, the shield of faith and the sword of the word. So many times we're too busy doing battle with each other. Well, I don't like the Catholics, I don't like the Pentecostals, or I don't like the Presbyterians, and we're all fighting with each other. Or we sit there and we're shining our armor up so much that it looks so beautiful, but the whole world is marching to hell in a handbasket because we're not keeping our focus on our commanding officer and obeying the orders that are passed down. That's the first general order that anybody in the military learns, to obey the orders of the officers above them. And that has to be our first general order in the army of Jesus Christ, is to obey the orders of our commanding officer. Amen? See, once the enemy takes the army's focus away from its leader and separates its veterans to choosing their own path, the army loses cohesiveness and effectiveness. We're no longer an effective army. When the church doesn't focus on Jesus, study his words, and work together as his church, Satan gains control. When soldiers of Christ's army, veterans of his church, march and step together under his flag, bearing the symbol of his cross, it's an awesome sight. Have you ever seen the army marching in a parade, and they're all in step, and they're carrying their flags high? It's very impressive to see that. Can you imagine the impressiveness of the whole army of Jesus Christ marching together as one unit, fighting the good fight? I'm going to tell you something. If we did that, if we came together, I don't care what's above the door of your church. I don't care if it says Catholic, Baptist, Pentecostal, Presbyterian, Methodist, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I don't care what it says. If we can agree that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, there is no other way but to get to heaven but by him. And it's only by his shed blood that we have remission of sins. We now have enough in common that we can agree upon that and fight together, and all the other stuff, all the semantics, we can just agree to disagree upon. So what if one of them says that they think that women should wear dresses and the other one says that women should be able to wear pants? So what? Is it going to keep people from going to heaven? Is it going to trap people into going to hell? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father but by me. And if we can agree upon that, then we can see people get into God's kingdom. All right? We can see the world get saved. We can see people marching toward heaven instead of toward hell. And as God's army, that is our responsibility. That is our calling to do that. We are veterans of his army. And we have to act like it. And if this is how we do it, no army can ever, ever come against us, especially Satan's army. There's a saying that we said right after 9/11. It says, united we stand, divided we fall. We need to stand together. Amen. If you've never accepted Jesus, stand with me, please. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to invite you to become part of His army. If you're here today or you're on live stream, whether watching on YouTube or on Facebook Live, and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, today is the day you can join His army and reap the benefits of eternal life. Reap the benefits of eternal health. Reap the benefits of right even right now where you're at. Before you cross that, before you die, you can say, oh, I have all this going on in my body. Well, by His stripes you were healed, according to 1 Peter 2:24. But you have to be in His army to reap the benefits. So I'm just asking you, if that's you today, all you got to do is pray with me. If you say, Pastor, I've marched in His army, but I went AWOL for a little while. I've gotten out of it. I just not doing what I should be doing. Well, guess what? Jesus is willing to forgive you and pardon you for being AWOL and bring you right back into the army to train you to fight the good fight. All you have to do is just say, yes, Jesus, that's what I want. So if you never accepted Him or you need to get back in His army today, just pray with me. Say, Jesus, I ask you today to save me from all my sins, to wash me white as snow with the blood of the Lamb. Here I am. I accept you as my commanding officer. And I pledge myself to follow you all of my days. In Jesus' name, amen. Make this song part of your prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that, Lord, in your army, God, Lord, you watch out for your troops. You take care of your troops, God. Lord, in your army, we devote ourselves to you, Lord. Lord, we follow you wherever you go. Today, God, we commit ourselves to you, Lord. We commit ourselves wholeheartedly, Lord, that nothing, God, nothing is above you. We don't place anything before you or above you, Lord. But today, that you welcome us, Lord, in your army. We fight the good fight because you are at our side. And Lord, we know because you're there, we are victorious, because your word says, greater is he that is in us, you, Lord, that is in us, than he that is in the world, our enemy. We thank you, God. We give you praise, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. If you would remain standing for me, just lift up your hands to receive the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. You may go in Jesus' name.